Coimbatore Medical College.
I can't see his face. Handsome man must be.
Yes, stop scares. Stop share screen.
I started sharing, sir. Is it visible, sir?
Oh, yes, of course. Very handsome. Married, is it, Kapil?
Kapil, you are very...
Kapil, are you married?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet. Okay, right. That's the correct answer. Not
eligible
yet.
Bachelor, sir. Eligible bachelor, yeah.
Yes, Tapan, are we live?
Yes, sir. We are live now, sir.
He is interested on Anko, sir.
Yes. Hello, everyone. The White Army is privileged to have Professor C. Rajesh Ballal, sir, K.S. Hegde Medical College, Mangalore, as our mentor today. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Also have with us Professor Srinivasan, sir, from Coimbatore Government Medical College. Welcome to you, sir.
Welcome.
Welcome, Professor Srinivasan, sir.
Welcome, sir. Thank you, sir. Welcome,
sir. Dr. Kapil Manohar, third year MS General Surgery, Coimbatore Government Medical College, has volunteered to present a case on carcinoma tongue today. Welcome to you, sir. I welcome all the attendees to this session. With our mentor's permission, we shall begin this session.
Yes, ma'am.
Over to you, Dr. Kapil.
Can I just ask a question before we start, Dr. Kapil?
Sure, sir.
Yes, sir. You can ask. You are the...
Are you okay if we interrupt you during the presentation, or you do you want me to wait till you finish the presentation?
As you wish, sir. Anything is fine for me, sir.
That may not be a very good idea, my friend. Isn't it? Okay, right. Let's see.
So, you decide, sir.
Yes, right. Okay. Go on.
Good evening, respected faculties and my colleagues. My name is Dr. Kapil Nath. So, I'll be presenting a case on a tongue lesion. I thank Professor Dr. Srinivasan, sir, for guiding me prepare this topic. So, I begin my topic now. A 56-year-old lady who is an housewife belonging to low socioeconomic status presented with complaints of ulcer over the left side of the tongue past 2 months duration with associated pain over the ulcer for the past 15 days. Patient was asymptomatic 2 months back when she noticed an ulcer over the left lateral aspect of tongue that was insidious in onset. Ulcer was initially smaller in size, which then gradually progressed to attain the present size of 4 into 2 centimeter. Ulcer was associated with pain, which gets aggravated on taking hot and spicy food. There's no history of restriction of mouth opening or tongue movement, no history of difficulty in speech or excessive salivation, no history of difficulty in swallowing, no history of earache, no history of repeated trauma from sharp tooth or dentures, no history of recent loosening of tooth, no history of any swelling in the neck.
Two questions. Just go back previous slide. Two questions. Why do you ask for history of restriction of mouth opening if there is a lesion in the tongue?
Sir, if there is involvement of floor of the mouth, there can be trismus.
Trismus is different. There can be trismus if there is the floor of the mouth is involved.
Yes, sir.
How does that happen?
If there is infiltration of the tumor in the floor of the mouth, that can lead to ankylo.
Mouth opening happens because of what? Which muscle?
The masseters, muscles of mastications.
Somebody here has written medial pterygoid. Is that correct? PK, somebody writes. Right, the next question. Why do you ask for history of recent loosening of the tooth?
Sir, if the tumor involves the alveolar sockets, there can be a loosening of tooth, sir.
But this is a lesion in the tongue, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Little difficult, no?
Yes, sir.
I suppose you must ask about history of a bleed. Whether the lady has noticed anything bleed from the ulcer.
Okay.
Isn't that? Okay. Yeah. Go on.
Past history. There's no previous history of ulceration, whitish or reddish patch in the tongue. No previous history of surgeries. No other comorbidities.
Have you finished with your history of present illness?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What sort of surgeries in the past?
Previously, whether she was operated for any buccomucosal lesion like leukoplakia.
Okay, which means you must say in the oral cavity.
Yes, sir.
See, examiner like me is jobless. I will ask history of some appendectomy, etc. You see, if you tell me history of PPS in the past, no relevance, no?
Yes, sir.
As a postgraduate, you must be specific. No history of surgeries inside the oral cavity. Okay. And you lead your examiner to where you want. Understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go on.
Personal history. Patient is a known tobacco abuser in past 10 years. She is on mixed diet, but recently takes only bland diet as the pain gets aggravated on taking spicy food. Sleep is undisturbed. Bowel bladder habits are normal. Obstetric history, para 2, life 2, normal vaginal delivery. There's no history of cancer-related deaths in the family. Summary, a 56-year-old lady who is a tobacco abuser with no known comorbidities presented with an ulceration over left lateral aspect of tongue past 2 months duration with gradual progression and association with pain.
For the benefit of your friends, can you tell me why you ask for history of pain in the ear?
So if there is involvement of glossopharyngeal nerve, there can be a radiation of pain to the ears, the ipsilateral ear.
Really? Glossopharyngeal radiates the pain to the ear?
Yes, sir.
Is that?
Posterior two-third of the tongue is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve, sir.
Okay. What has that got to do with the ear? Anybody in this? There is a chat box also. Sanjana to everyone. Lingual nerve and have you heard of this? Lingual nerve, auricular temporal nerve?
Yes, sir. It's a branch of
branches of
mandibular division of glossopharyngeal nerves.
Right. So you don't have to get in the glossopharyngeal nerve.
Okay, sir.
And this mandibular division of the glossopharyngeal, is it? Oops. Mandibular is one of three divisions of something
else. Trigeminal nerve.
Yes. Sir. Do I look that bad?
No, sir. No, sir. Please, sir. He got somebody.
Sir is so. I mean, no, I'm not that bad at all. Okay.
Sir, please, sir. Then you are looking very smart. Jacobson's branch of glossopharyngeal.
Somebody. Okay, you must see. These are standard questions you get asked anywhere. If you make a statement, somebody will ask you. So you have answers ready. Understand?
Yes, sir.
The most common is the lingual and the auricular temporal. Easiest to explain. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Go on. If you have any questions, please put it in the chat box. If I know, I will answer. Yeah, go on.
Examination of the patient. I've examined the patient with informed consent in a well-lit room and adequate exposure in the presence of family attendant. Patient is conscious, coherent, and cooperative with a BMI of 22. Hydration status well maintained. ECOG score of 1. There's no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or generalized lymphadenopathy. Pulse rate is 78 per minute in right radial artery, normal volume, regular rhythm. BP is 120 by 80 millimeters of mercury in right arm, supine position. Patient is afebrile with respiratory rate of 14 per minute.
If you mention the ECOG score, somebody will ask you the similar score. What's the other similar score?
Sir, Karnofsky score, sir.
Karnofsky. So it's better you know. In the ECOG, one is best or worst?
One is best, sir.
In the Karnofsky?
The Karnofsky above 90 is better, sir.
Right. So it's reverse of each other.
Yes, sir.
Understand? In the ECOG, as the score goes up, you find that the patient's general condition comes down. It's different in Karnofsky.
Yes, sir.
Understand? ECOG, you start from 1, 2, 4, 5. In Karnofsky, you start from 100 and come down to 0. Okay? Yes, right.
This is usually a short case, isn't it, sir, Rajesh, sir?
Yeah. Whatever, sir. No problem. Short can be made long. Long can be made short.
That is. It depends on us.
Right.
This is a clinical picture of the patient.
One suggestion, please black out the eyes.
Sure, sir. Identity. Go to the next slide.
right? With questions of identity, even Facebook, etc., is very clear now. Even though it's a closed group, it is safer, right? And you guys are much more computer savvy than we are.
Definitely.
Right? You put a black strip on the eyes.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
On inspection, mouth opening is adequate. There's no halitosis. Facial symmetry is maintained. There's no deviation of tongue. Tobacco staining of tooth noted.
One basic question. Suppose the tongue gets deviated, what's the significance?
Sir, if there is infiltration or involvement of the hypoglossal nerve, there will be deviation to the same side, sir.
Why does that happen? If the left hypoglossal nerve is paralyzed, the tongue deviates to the left side, is it? That's what you're telling me?
Yes, sir.
Right. Why does it happen?
Because the opposite side fibers, they contract, there will be decussation of fibers.
Which fiber, my friend?
What is the muscle which comes in survival? That's what sir is asking. Which pushes it to the other side.
Somebody called PK has put already.
The unopposed action of the opposite side. So which muscle is this? It's a simple question, ba, Kapil.
Intrinsic muscle, sir.
What? Since when intrinsic muscles start pushing tongues this side and that side, man? So no hyoglossus question mark. This probably genioglossus is probably the answer what you're looking for. Right. The intrinsic muscles change the shape of the tongue. Right?
Okay, sir.
The lateral movements are by preferably, I don't think it's a longitudinal muscle. Teju is written. I don't think so. I would rather go with genioglossus. Yeah, go on.
On inspection, there is an ulceroproliferative lesion noted in the left lateral border of anterior two-third of the tongue, measuring about 4 into 2 centimeters, with irregular and averted borders, surrounding edema noted. There's no involvement of floor of the mouth, no swelling or ulceration noted in the posterior one-third of the tongue. The tongue movements are normal. Rest of the oral cavity, the palate, the buccal mucosa, floor of the mouth, the tonsillar fossa are found to be normal.
You're on inspection, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
How did you look at swelling or ulceration in the posterior third of the tongue?
Sir, I've palpated with my index finger, sir.
Okay, let me ask you another question. How do you inspect the posterior third of the tongue? If Kapil doesn't answer, somebody else can answer. No problem. All of us learn together.
How do you look for the posterior one-third, Kapil?
I'll give you options. Open the mouth, ask two people to pull the tongue out. Will it come?
No, sir.
No, I tell my students like Draupadi Vastraparanda, will it come?
No, sir. Only on tongue depressor we have to see.
Tongue depressor. Depressing answer. Yes, Amina, that's what I want to know. She says, cannot. So I want to know, there's somebody called Amina Shahala. How do you look at the posterior third of the tongue? Indirect laryngoscope. Sorry. Oh, this is Kishan. This is unfair.
No, not me, sir. It's Tappan. It's a fourth year student. He's answering, sir.
Oh, okay. He puts indirect
fourth laryngoscope. Fourth year MBBS student from Guwahati.
Indirect laryngoscopy, question mark. What, Kapil, you agree or don't?
That doesn't come under inspection, sir.
No, my friend. I said, I'm asking a question. How do you look at the posterior third of the tongue? So somebody, apparently fourth year student, says you need to do an indirect laryngoscopy. Agreed or disagreed?
Yes, sir. We want to inspect. We have to go in for indirect laryngoscopy, sir.
For palpation, it's possible. Why you can't pull the tongue and look at the posterior third?
Sir, it will be difficult for the patient.
I see. Okay. Not to me. Anybody? Yes, that same fourth year student? Please tell me, why do you need an IDM to look at the posterior third of the tongue and can't pull the tongue out so that you can see the posterior third of the tongue? The posterior third of the tongue is a part of what structure? Anatomy. Is it in the oral cavity? Really? Posterior third of the tongue, like somebody has written here, is in the oropharynx. So there's no way you can pull it into the oral cavity. So to look at the posterior third of the tongue, you need an ideal. Understand? No tongue depressor.
Yes, sir. It
forms the anterior wall of the oropharynx. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go on. Okay, okay.
On palpation, there's an ulcero proliferative lesion noted over the lateral border of anterior two-third of the tongue, measuring about 4 into 2 cm, which bleeds on handling, firm in consistency with uneven surface, irregular margin with surrounding induration, extending about 0.5 centimeters around the ulcer. There's no extension to the floor of the mouth or jaw.
I'm not agreeing with this. You must describe more on palpation as to, see, you said lateral border, anterior two-thirds. That's not enough for me.
Okay, sir.
What is the anterior extent? What is the posterior extent?
Sir, anteriorly, it extends up to the tip of the tongue, sir. Crossing the midline, just crosses the midline.
Oh, okay. Okay. Posteriorly, 4 centimeters.
Posteriorly, it is just 1 centimeter from the midline, sir.
But it was on the lateral aspect. Okay. So it's crossing the midline anteriorly. The tip of the tongue is involved.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay.
You put that photo first.
Yeah, I thought it was a little posterior. Okay, doesn't matter. Okay, right. And what is the induration?
So induration, there is an area of induration 0.5 centimeters around.
How do you know it's induration when you palpate it?
The consistency seems different from the rest of the tongue, sir.
Right. Hard, soft, firm?
Firm in consistency.
Yeah, probably. Somebody said hardening. I would rather agree with firm. Yes, fair. And what's the significance?
Say, it has a role during surgery, sir, during the management process.
Oh, fine, fine. We'll find out later on. Yeah. During the management, it's important. We leave it at that. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Go on, go on. Go on.
Yes, sir. The slides are not moving. So this
you thing. Click on the screen, pa.
Oh, okay, okay.
You click on the screen.
Yes, sir.
Kapil, sorry to interrupt, sir. One question. How do you check for the induration? What are the procedure? Can you please explain for us? One important point to be noted there while examining for the any tremors in the trunk or maybe induration, what precaution you take?
I'll palpate with my index and thumb finger.
Okay.
Look for the consistency.
Okay. The what position?
Of the tongue, not of the patient.
Yeah.
Asking the patient to protrude the tongue.
That's the mistake. That's the mistake. Expect. Okay. So always it should be in the resting position inside the oral cavity. Okay. The tongue should be in the relaxed position, especially for even for thyrotoxicosis, we look for the tremors in that condition also. You have to keep the tongue relaxed inside the oral cavity. Then, as you like you told, using two fingers, look for the palpate for the like hardening or consistency. Okay. What condition do we get this induration of the tongue? Can you name some conditions?
Sir, syphilitic glossitis, sir.
Gumatus ulcer. Another thing, SCC of tongue, okay? Squamous cell carcinoma, we get the induration. Very good. Please go ahead.
I'm
moving it.
Take the cursor and say, double click on the screen bar.
Yes, sir. I'm doing that, but it's not responding.
You stop, I'll share for you.
Yes, sir.
I thought the idea of this was all of us learn together, Kapil.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it?
Definitely.
Oh, so many things we learn from you.
You close the screen.
Yes, sir.
That's right. You sent one to You sent one to the Pallavi or Kishan one copy? He's held up. Kapil?
Kapil is... can you... I don't think anybody else is on live, sir. Kapil also is not moving at all.
No. I think he's got some challenges with the net connection.
I think so, yeah. He's
mostly there is network problems.
Network, okay, right.
Who's the HOD now, sir? Rajshekhar, sir?
Yes.
Other Bhagwan sir is there, huh?
Yes, Bhagwan is there, yes. You probably know BK also, isn't it? BK Shetty?
BK Shetty, no, sir. I didn't. Oh, last okay. Time I didn't see.
Okay.
Yes, you introduced him to me, sir.
Oh, okay.
You're able to see the screen?
Yeah. Kapil can see?
Kapil, are you there? Kapil?
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Yes.
Please go on. Yes. You made a statement, said not extending to the jaw. How did you look for, Kapil, on palpation?
Sir, any irregularity in the gum, in the gingival buccal region, the mandibles?
Okay, fair. Right.
This is a clinic of the patient there.
Yeah.
Does it look continuous, sir? Continuous or is this?
Looks larger than 4/2.
Yes, sir.
Okay, doesn't matter. Okay, go on.
Examination of the neck. Palpitus.
Oral cavity examination over?
Yes, sir. The rest of the oral cavity, the buccal mucosa, the retromolar trigon, the cheek seems to be normal, sir.
Okay.
So examination of the neck, palpated from behind the patient with neck in slight flexion. There is no cervical lymphadenopathy noted.
Why flex the neck?
So that the muscles relax and
which muscle? Able to,
the sternocleidomastoid, the trapezius.
Why you want to relax the sternocleidomastoid? So the sternocleidomastoid becomes taut if you extend the neck, is it?
No, sir.
Batting like RCB, man. RCB and IPL.
So, sir, which plane?
Sorry, sir.
Which plane? The lymph nodes are in. Sir, you really need to relax the muscle. That's what sir is asking you.
Okay, it's actually above the deep fascia, sir.
Above. Superficial or deep to deep fascia? The nodes that you are interested in.
Yes,
superficial or deep to the deep fascia?
Deep to deep fascia.
So what happens if you extend the neck for the deep fascia? I think you're speaking of the investing layer, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Right. What happens to the investing layer if you extend the neck?
They become taut, sir.
Palpation becomes more difficult.
Yes, sir.
Right. And like Dr. Kishan was saying, you're interested in, that's why you need to flex the neck. So palpation becomes easier.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Right.
Examination of the cranial nerves 9, 10, and 12 were normal.
Why do you examine 9, 10, 12?
Yes, sir. Examine for these three cranial nerves, sir.
Why?
Why you examine?
So, to look for any infiltration in this nerve, sir.
Where? 9, 10, where are the infiltrated?
So in case of extending to the posterior of the tongue.
You said Kapil. It's normal.
Kapil, you said 9, 10, 12. 9, how did you look for? 10, how did you look for? 12, how did you look for? See, you put the question.
Yes.
You are trying. Now you examined the cranial nerve 9, what did you do? For 10, what did you do? For 12, what did you do?
Sir, for 9, I just asked the patient to stick out the tongue and look for the soft palate and the uvula, sir, whether any deviation is there. On both the sides of uvula.
No, sir is not agreeing.
Not agreeing. 9 and 10, you can examine with the same test.
the gag reflex, sir. So stimulating the posterior pharyngeal wall and looking for the gag reflex.
Right. What happened? How do you examine? Which is 9, which is 10 in this? In the gag reflex.
Sir, the movement of the soft palate and uvula indicates 12th, I mean, glossopharyngeal nerve, sir. 9th, 20.
Glossopharyngeal motor or sensory?
Sensory.
Then how can it, the muscle move, my friend? In the gag reflex, the afferent is the glossopharyngeal. The sensory part is the glossopharyngeal. The motor part, the efferent, is the 10th cranial nerve. Understand? There's okay. a chat on the chat box. There's a question slash comment from somebody called Sumant. Can lymph node swellings can compress the nerves? Question mark.
Yes sir. Yes, sir. The lymph node can compress the hypoglossal nerve.
Where? Which lymph node? Where?
Jugular group of nodes.
You must talk. Today you must talk about level. I'm not agreeing for jugular.
He's got some challenges with the...
Yes, I think.
Net.
We can't, you're not audible.
You can tell them, sir, please.
You need to switch off your Kapil. If you don't have a better good internet, please switch off your video so that you'll get a better
which is fair. Yeah. Do that, yeah.
Sir, Kapil, even 9, sir, 9, 10, yeah, and 12.
Can you switch off your video, Kapil, so that you'll get a better internet connection?
Sure, sir.
Yeah, perfect.
Right, okay. Sumant, only way that can happen is if you have large level 3 nodes sitting at the carotid bifurcation. And that's where the hypoglossal will come in between. If you remember in anatomy, the hypoglossal comes and in between the carotid bifurcation. That's where it may get compressed. I hope I answered your question. Sumant?
Yes, sir. You'll say yes.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. Okay, Kapil, continue. Right. Okay. Yes. Okay. Please continue, Kapil.
So the examination of the cardiovascular system, the respiratory system, abdomen, skull and spine were found to be within normal limits. So summary, 56-year lady who is a tobacco abuser with no known comorbidities, presenting with an ulceration over the left lateral aspect of tongue for the past 2 months duration with association pain with a 4 into 2 cm ulcero-proliferative lesion in the left lateral aspect of tongue with irregular margin which bleeds on touch, surrounding induration with no palpable cervical nodes. So my clinical diagnosis is carcinoma anterior 2/3 tongue, left lateral border, clinical staging T2N0M0, which is stage 2.
Couple of things in this before we go ahead. Induration for the patient, good sign, bad sign?
It's a bad sign, so it's an extension of the tumor.
The hardening is because of what?
It's actually a desmoplastic reaction from inflammation.
So if it is a desmoplastic reaction, does it limit the spread of the tumor or does it allow the tumor to grow?
Yes, it limits the spread of the tumor.
So is that a good sign or a bad sign?
Good sign.
Right. So for the patient, it is good. For you, it means something else.
Okay.
So if you have a 4x2 cm lesion without induration and a 4x2 cm lesion with induration, the person with induration has developed some sort of reaction towards the malignancy. The body is trying to restrict the malignancy within that particular area. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you're convinced this is squamous cell?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Because the most common carcinoma in buccal mucosa is squamous cell variety, sir.
No, no. This is the tongue. It's not buccal mucosa. Most common is squamous cell, which means there are other less common things.
Yes, adenocarcinoma is very rare, sir.
Right. Suppose this lesion was not indurated and did not bleed on touch. Can you think of anything else? All other findings are the same. 4x2.
Okay, sir.
Tip of the tongue, extending lateral, left lateral, this one of the tongue. No nodes. No nodes are unusual. But are you aware of any other malignancy which can present like this, an irregular ulcerated growth in the tongue?
Sir, benign conditions like traumatic ulcer or tuberculosis ulcer.
Malignancy. Any other malignancy?
Sir, any minor salivary gland tumors can present this way, sir.
Does it happen like that? You get this sort of ulcerating?
They can present with the swelling. Minor salivary gland tumors, they can present swelling in the tongue, sir.
Verrucous carcinoma is a variant of what, PK? Verrucous carcinoma is again a variant of a squamous cell. So can you think of any other malignancy if it is not an adenocarcinoma, if it is not a squamous cell? Just a theory question. I agree with you. The most common is an SCC. Lymphomas don't present with ulcerated lesions, Sumant. Epithelioma is another variation of
mucocutaneous neuromas can present.
Malignancy, my friend. Malignancy. Neuromas are not malignant. Unless you talk of a neurofibrosarcoma.
Anything you can think between the epithelial and the adenocarcinoma? Any transitional variety?
I don't know if me and Kishan are asking the same thing. I don't know. Could this be a melanoma?
Melanoma.
Okay, sir.
Could this be?
Yes, sir. It is possible, sir. Amelanotic variety.
So you must talk of an amelanotic variety. Okay. If at all you're talking of an melanoma, this will be an amelanotic melanoma. What is against a melanoma in this physical findings?
Sir, with this lesion, there will be definitely enlarged nodes.
Need not be. Okay. Agreed. In the tongue examination.
There's no pigmented lesions.
Agreed. That's why I call it an amelanotic, you see. Anybody? PK, Sanjana, Sumant, Sureka, AKM256. Wow, that's a nice name. Usually, you don't get induration in melanomas. You find the melanomas grow so rapidly, there's no time for the body to develop, to produce induration. Understand? But somewhere, if it does not fit into a squamous cell, you must somewhere in the back of the mind think of an amelanotic melanoma. Yeah, go on. T2N0, M0, you said.
Yes, sir.
Because?
TNM staging, the size of the tumor is less than 4 centimeters. Equal to or less than 4 centimeters, it comes under T2 lesions.
Have you heard of any recent advances in AJCC?
Sir, the 8th edition of AJCC takes into consideration the depth of invasion also. Sir.
Right. So, you may be excused for calling it a T2, but I suppose if, depends on where your exam is going. If your examiner wants, it may be safer to say, I want to look at the depth of invasion before saying it is a T2 lesion.
Okay, sir.
Understand. From the size wise, I agree. T2, no lymph nodes according to you, N0, M0. MX would probably be better. What are the chances of you having a T2, N0, M1 lesion?
N0 and M1, sir?
Yes. Let's say you get a CT chest for whatever reason.
Okay, sir.
You know, many places for the scheme, government scheme, you must get certain stupid investigation. So let's say you get a CT and you pick up, what are the chances of picking up a lesion in the lung without neck nodes?
Sir, it is very unlikely, sir, because the tongue is rich in lymphatics, sir. So there will definitely be a nodal spread before going for...
Very true. All oral malignancies these malignancies have a stepwise spread. Unlike one other famous malignancy. This is out of portions. Unlike one other famous malignancy, you can, in the absence of lymph nodes also, you can get distant metastasis. True. Somebody said breast. In the breast, you must realize that more and more of us believe that the breast is, carcinoma of breast is a systemic disease. So you can get a node negative, metastasis positive. That doesn't usually happen with oral cancers.
Okay, sir.
Right, okay. Anybody else has any question before we go on?
Can you please tell us the lymphatic drainage of the tongue, please?
Yes, sir. They drain into jugular group of lymph nodes, sir. Level 2, 3, 4 nodes. And skip metastasis is common in...
The area-wise drainage, can you please tell us the tip, where does it drain, which group of... because it has got area-wise drainage, no? If the ulcer is in the tip of the tongue, we can make out like most probably that submental. You are right. They can have skip metastasis to level 3 or 4. But usually, the tip drains to the submental
and
submental. The lateral margins drains to the ipsilateral submandibular nodes, right? The central area of the tongue, again, drains to the bilateral submandibular group of nodes. And posterior one-third of the tongue drains to?
Level 2, 3.
No. Yeah, that is a jugulo-omohyoid group of bilateral. Okay, so lymphatics is it's rich in lymphatics, and lymphatic drainage very important in oral cavity cancers. Okay, so for the neck dissection as well.
Kapil, one unfair question. What's the nerve supply of the tongue? Unfair.
Sir, the somatic sensation is by the lingual nerve, sir.
Okay.
The taste sensation is by the caudate tympani. I mean, branch of facial.
Yes.
Nerve.
That's only part of the answer.
And hypoglossal nerve supply the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. Right. The extrinsic muscles supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerves.
Achche. How can it be, man? How can glossopharyngeal supply it? It's a sensory nerve, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
The development of the anterior 2/3 and the posterior 1/3 are different. Then you must talk of the arches of the tongue. Isn't it? You heard of these arches? Sorry, not arches of the tongue. You heard of the arches? Pharyngeal arches?
Yes, sir.
Right? So the anterior 2/3 develop from which arch? The posterior 1/3 and the posterior most segment develops from which arches? And what is the nerve supply? No, unfair question. Nothing to do with carcinoma tongue, but... I like the name AKM256. Can anybody answer, please? Nerve supply of the tongue, more detailed. Anterior from the first arch, gulp. Anterior 2/3 lingual nerve, he said. Posterior from third arch, true. What's the nerve of the third arch? AJU-SR.
Glossopharyngeal nerve.
Right. So we find there's a facial supplying the anterior 2/3 via the lingual nerve. And then, the caudate tympani. And then you have the glossopharyngeal, thus supplying the posterior 1/3. Okay, go on. T2N0, M0, go on.
Dr. Kapil, have you examined the mandible?
He said.
Yes, sir. I just palpated for any irregularity along the alveolar region. Around the gingiva buccal region,
sir. Apart from irregularity, you're supposed to look for thickening, isn't it?
Yes,
thickening,
sir.
Is a better term. Okay, Kapil. Yes. Sir, thickening of the mandible is the better terminology.
Okay, sir.
And how do you look for thickening?
Sir,
what special test you do here?
The orthopantomogram.
No. Palpation only. It's called bidigital palpation.
Okay, sir.
How do you do?
The thumb is outside and the index finger is inside the oral cavity.
Where's the other digit? Bidigital means two digits.
Okay, yes, one finger you should keep inside, another on the outside over the mandible, and go along the ramus of the mandible. Okay, if you find out any thickening, then we can infer there is a involvement of the mandible. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Does that mean new bone is being laid down, Kapil? The bone is thick.
Sir, unlikely if the patient had any history of trauma.
No, my friend, with the malignancy. We are not going away from malignancy today.
Okay, sir.
In the malignancy, if the mandible is thick on bidigital palpation, somebody is keeping on writing bony infiltration. It's not, no new bone gets laid down. Understand? Yes, it's more like a periosteal reaction. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Go on. Go on. Go on.
So, I would like to do basic investigations. An investigation to confirm my diagnosis, to stage the disease, and for the management process.
By basic, I thought you mean hemoglobin total differential and urine examination, is it?
I said for the assessment part.
Right. Kishan, can we skip that? We'll say it is normal?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, yes, ejection, yes, fraction, yes, ejection fraction excellent, no cholesterol. Okay?
Perfect.
Right. Okay. Because otherwise, he'll say, I want to send it to physician to give insulin or not. Don't want. Okay? Specific investigations.
So I'll do a HVH biopsy from the lesion and confirm my diagnosis.
Anesthesia or no anesthesia?
So without anesthesia, sir.
She'll keep the tongue outside. Or the tongue inside the mouth?
Sir, I'll ask her to protrude the tongue.
Okay.
And I take a biopsy on the edge of the lesion.
With your PPE kit?
Yes, sir.
And she is happy sleeping with her tongue outside the oral cavity. Is it?
It's quite difficult, but
in the exam, it may be safer to say, I want to give anesthesia. Your examiner may not agree. That's different.
Okay.
Sir. All of us in government hospital have cut corners. But the exam is a little difficult area. You see, you'll find one fellow like me saying, what happens, doctor? This happens, that happens, etc. Okay, let me ask you. Is there a risk in doing what you've done?
I mean, without anesthesia taking
blood. Yes.
The patient can go in for pain shock aspiration.
Right. So it can bleed. And if it bleeds, it'll get into the pharynx. Right. Nobody wants to be in that scenario. Right. Yes. I agree. All of us have done this. Anybody?
Sir, somebody was asking me, right, like in the chat section, how to manage while doing the examination if it starts bleeding. On bleeds on touch, it's heavy, bleeds heavily, sir. So how can we manage or what can we do to prevent? Yeah,
I will put adrenaline gauze and wait.
Yeah, that's okay. Students also asked the question. Yeah. Sir is telling we can put the pressure, okay, pressure gauze, apply for some 4-5 minutes, 10 minutes. Soaked with adrenaline is better always for vasoconstriction. So that would suffice, okay, most of the times.
Doesn't stop, we refer to Kishan.
Yes.
What do you say? Isn't it? Is anyway doing cardiothoracic, I believe.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
He knows from aorta upwards, sir, so it's okay. Isn't it? Yes, okay, right. So you want to get an edge wedge biopsy, whatever. What do you find in a squamous cell?
Squamous cell writing.
What do you find?
The squamous cell carcinoma, a moderately differentiated grade.
How do you know this? What will the pathologist see?
They'll look for a keratin pearls, sir.
If there are no keratin pearls?
Probably a poorly differentiated grades.
Oh. Whose grading are we talking about?
Sir, if the keratin pearls are accurately seen, it indicates a well-differentiated grade.
What is the name of the grading is asking, sir? Who's grading?
Somebody has written here, Sureka writes, Broaddus classification. So can somebody tell me what is the Broaddus classification of squamous cell? Well, moderate, poorly, some of us say anaplastic or whatever, depends on what? Sureka, Sumant?
Degree of differentiation of the cells, sir.
Where is the keratin pulse coming in? Does not depend on the depth, PK. Where does the keratin pearl come in? Somebody has written here 25%, 50, 75 keratin pearls. True or false? From the White Army to everyone. 25%, 50, 75 keratin pearls. True or false?
Kapil, answer.
Yeah, anybody. Anybody can answer. Broaddus classification, when I asked, somebody has written here, 25%, 50, 75 keratin pearls. Yes or no?
Tapan, you can unmute yourself and answer, dear.
Ah, yeah.
Tapan, any of you, if you're finding difficulty in typing, you can directly unmute yourself and answer, okay? Tapan, please.
Sir. And I don't know who you are. You don't know who I am. So this is the best place.
Sir, means if it is above 75%, then it is well differentiated. If it is 50 to 75%,
of what?
Percent of keratin pulse within the cellless beyond the basement membrane, sir.
I'm sorry, I'm not agreeing with that. This is a popular misconception. Broaders has nothing to do with the keratin pulse. Broaders depends on the differentiation. Keratin pulse means they are nests of keratin. Usually they are seen in well-differentiated. I'm very clear. Keratin pulse are usually seen in well-differentiated squamous cells. But the difference, the Broaders classification depends on the percentage of differentiated cells. Understand, whoever answered just now.
Okay.
If it is more than 75% of differentiated cells, it's called a well-differentiated. Nothing to do with keratin pulse. Okay.
Grade 1, Broaders classification, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. Grade 1 is 0 to 25% of undifferentiated cells. Okay. 25 to 50, 50 to 75, grade 75 is grade 3. More than 75% of the undifferentiated cells are there, then it's grade 4. Okay, that's Broaders classification.
Are we clear?
Yes, sir.
Common mistake, people say keratin pulse and this. No, it's not true. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Right, so we'll call it moderately differentiated. What happens next?
So I'll clinically, the nodes are not palpable. So I'll do an ultrasonogram of neck to look for any nodes.
Ultrasound of the neck is done with what sort of this one? Ultrasound probe? Same as the abdomen, different?
It's a different, sir. For skin and superficial lesions, we do more than 5 megahertz.
For people who are not aware, what is the usual thing for the abdomen? What's the megahertz for the abdomen usually?
Sir, 2 megahertz, sir. Less than 2.
It's about 4. For the abdomen is 4. At least you need to know that you need to use a higher frequency probe when you're using superficial structures, because that's how the ultrasound works. Right. You do an ultrasound. What are the suspicious features of a node?
Sir, usually the nodes are bean shaped, sir. If this shape is altered, it is suspicious of malignancy.
Agreed.
And the loss of peripheral hilar fat.
Maybe.
Increased vascularity.
Somebody said loss of fatty hilum, yes. Somebody says more than 1 centimeter short axis diameter. I'm not sure. Taller than wider, I agree. Okay, so there are suspicious, this one on the ultrasound. 2 patients. One has suspicious level 2 lymph node. The other one, ultrasound is normal.
Okay, sir.
What will you do for the first patient with the suspicious lesion on the ultrasound? Clinically N0.
Okay, sir. I'll do an ultrasound guided FNAC of the lesion.
Okay. For the?
The suspicious
one. Okay, we'll keep it at that. Okay. Go on.
So what are the investigations?
So usually, metastatic workup is not mandatory for these lesions, unless clinically we are suspicious. There's no requirement of any CT chest or abdomen, sir.
I'm not sure it is so straightforward. An intelligent answer would be...
In the oral cavity only, any other imaging modality is required?
Yeah.
MRI of the oral cavity is more useful to look for soft tissue. X-ray? Yes, sir. X-ray or CT to look for any cortical involvement.
Okay, you tell me which is better now. Okay, MRI is for soft tissue. Okay, delineation, MRI is the gold standard. Agreed.
Yes, sir.
And X-ray and CT?
Yes, sir.
For bone invasion, what do you do?
If we are suspicious that the tumor is infiltrating the bones, we go in for CT. Mandible region.
X-ray is not that sensitive. Okay, here. More than, if there is a loss of more than 50% of the calcium deposits there, only then it's apparent in the X-rays. So it's better to... For gold standard is CT scan. Okay, we can go for CT scan for the bone involvement and for the soft tissue delineation. MRI for oral, sir. Rajesh, sir, you should please tell us for oral cavity maintenance. MRI is considered to be the gold standard, right, sir?
Yeah, probably, yes. Now, I was slightly trying to raise a little different point.
Okay.
In a postgraduate exam today with HSCC 8, if you say T2, N0, M0 clinically, I would rather allow a good student to tell me what is the depth of invasion on a biopsy. Because if the depth of the invasion is more than 10 millimeters, automatically it gets upstaged.
Yes, sir.
Kapil?
Yes, sir. Definitely. Right?
So it may be safer. A good postgraduate, I would expect you to, you were telling the examiner, look here, I've read AJCC 8.
Yes, sir.
Understand?
Yes, sir.
You say, I want to look at the depth of invasion on a biopsy and then restage and see where we are.
Okay, sir.
Kishan accepted?
Exactly, sir. Exactly.
Right? Because, see, we gone are those days wherein, you know, for me, we didn't even have an MR. So, you're very happy. You do a biopsy, squamous cell and operate. Those days are gone, man. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Right. So, we'll keep it at T2, N0, M0. At the end of the... Any other investigations?
Sir, MRI alone, sir. MRI.
Yeah, you said MRI. Yes. We presume is normal. Everything is normal.
Yes, sir. Right. Investigation part is over, sir.
Right. Sir, anything else? Dr. Srinivasan, sir?
No,
any
sir.
Any other investigations?
No, it's fine, sir.
Should be all right. Kishan?
We can proceed with my treatment, sir.
Yes, yes.
Sir, in this case, I would go in for a hemiglossectomy with 1 centimeter marginal clearance with bilateral...
It's crossing the midline, you said.
Yes.
The tip of the tongue.
Yes, sir.
So, what will be your management in this case? With the SARS findings, no lymph nodes, depth of the invasion is less than 10 millimeter.
Sir, a wide excision with 1 centimeter clearance and suprahomoid neck dissection bilaterally.
Hmm. How wide? 1 centimeter margin.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, how much of the tongue will come out?
Sir, more than 1/3 will be, I mean, more than 50% of the tongue will be lost. Sir. It actually amounts to hemiglossectomy, sir.
No. Hemiglossectomy is a, if as long as I have understood, is the right or the left half of the tongue gets removed.
Yes, sir.
Right. Here, you're not talking of that. Sir made a very pertinent point. He said, this is the one which is crossing the midline.
Yes, sir.
Right. So, I don't think taking out the anterior half of the tongue amounts to what is called a hemiglossectomy.
Okay, sir. So, I thought 50% of the tongue.
No. It's hemi is one side.
Okay, sir.
A SARS side is one side only. When it crosses the midline, you are going for a?
Total glossectomy, sir.
No, it will become, why you want to do a total glossectomy? Why not do a wide excision like you said and stick to that?
Yes, sir. Wide excision with 1 centimeter margin clearance, sir.
So, depends on what, the tip of the tongue will go. A portion of the left side of the tongue will go and a large portion of the right side of the tongue will go.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Right. N0 neck, no?
It is N0 neck, sir, but
yes.
There is a chance of more than 20% chance of involvement of neck nodes. So,
the same lesion was in the buccal mucosa? T2 N0 in the buccal mucosa. Would your treatment be different or is all the same?
There's 20% chance as well. If it is a young patient,
and buccal mucosa also.
Buccal mucosa, not sure, sir. I'm not sure.
Right, buccal mucosa. Tongue lesions are in general more aggressive or less aggressive than buccal mucosa?
Sir, more aggressive because of extensive lymphatics and bilateral crossing over.
Tongue lesions, as a general rule, behave more aggressively compared to buccal mucosa. Understand? No controversy about this. N0 neck, you have to do a suprahomoid, which includes removal of
level 1, 2 and 3 nodes, sir. In extended suprahomoid, we also remove level 4 nodes, sir.
No, you want to do?
Sir, Supra, Homa, your neck dissection and FNAC, I'll do intraoperative frozen section.
Of which node? All, 1, 2, 3.
1, 2, and 3, sir.
All.
Yes, sir. Frozen. Sir, if there is a extra capsular invasion or bulky nodes, and I will proceed with modified radical neck dissections.
This is an N0 neck on ultrasound also.
Yes, sir.
You got an ultrasound of the neck which showed no suspicious features.
Yes, sir.
I'm not sure. I don't know. If you get a good ultrasound of the neck, somebody says only level 3. No. You must do a supra homo head, yes. But this on table frozen section for 1, 2 and 3, I'm not agreeing. You got a little mixed up. Yes, you must get a frozen section if you are worried about which node I want to know.
Level 2, definitely, sir.
Why level 2?
Since it is the tip of the tongue, I'll level 1 and level 2, sir. Submental and submandibular nodes.
Okay, we leave it at this moment. The next patient is a level 2 positive node on ultrasound. You got an FNA, shows metastasis in a level 2.
Okay, sir.
The same findings. What will you do? Left level 2 is enlarged. Is ultrasound proven metastasis?
Yes, sir. I'll do intraoperative frozen section of level 4 node, sir. So if it is found positive, I'll go in for modified radical neck dissection.
I think today you must call it a functional neck. I don't think you must call it a modified radical. You must call it a functional neck dissection.
Okay, sir.
Right. When you're doing a supra homo hyoid, if you have a no suspicious nodes on your investigation, a good investigation, I don't think you need to do a level 1, 2 frozen section. You do a 3 if you're worried. If the 3 is positive, you need to go one level beyond. That will be a 4.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
You need to reconstruct the tongue?
Yes, sir. Definitely, the reconstruction has to be done to improve the quality of speech and swallowing.
If you have half the tongue, the speech is poor, is it?
The disarticulation will be a problem, sir. The quality of speech.
Articulation, not disarticulation. Articulation will be a problem, is it?
Sir, articulation will be affected. And even
if you take out the entire tongue, can the person talk? Theory question.
Yes.
Total glossectomy, can the person talk, or like some of us in the exam, can't talk? You come for exam, it's motor aphasia, can't talk. Kapil.
Sir, they can talk, sir, but the quality, sir, of speech will be affected. Sir.
What's that called? What's that speech called?
Dysarthria, sir.
Achcha. No, sir. Anybody on the chat box? If you do a total glossectomy, Kapil says he can still talk, but he calls it dysarthria, which is not true.
Dyslexia, sir.
Che, no man. It's okay. It's called laryngeal speech. It's okay. Doesn't matter.
Okay, sir.
Right. Why reconstruct? If you don't reconstruct the tongue, what problem she may have?
She'll be having a difficulty in grinding the food, swallowing the food.
And really?
There can be repeated aspirations.
Not agreeing. Sir, I'm not agreeing. This patient, if you take out part of the tongue, he says he'll aspirate. I'm not agreeing. Kishan?
Manipulation of food.
Kishan is with us?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
When does aspiration happen, Kapil?
The tongue is fixed due to tumor. It is fixed.
If you take out a portion of the anterior portion of the tongue, I don't think any aspiration will happen. Certain vowels, certain consonants, etc., where you need the tongue to touch the lips or touch the palate, the tip of the tongue, those vowels may have a problem. Right? In the exam, I suppose you were expected to say, I want to reconstruct. Okay, but you must be aware that you'll be surprised as to if you take out a portion of the anterior portion of the tongue, nothing much may happen. Okay. How do you reconstruct?
Sir, I'll use a radial forearm free flap for reconstruction.
Mm-hmm. You want to use the bone also?
Yes, sir. For bone, if there is a mandibular invasion and I'm doing a hemimandibular.
This patient.
Bony reconstruction, sir?
No, this patient, what do you want to reconstruct? You are the gentleman who's removed.
Yes, sir.
You want to reconstruct.
Sir, local flaps like nasolabial flap.
Nasolabial.
I can put in a split skin grafting also, sir.
There's a lot of volume deficit is there. Okay, almost you're telling hemiglossectomy means half of the tongue will go. Or if there is less than one third of the tongue goes also, you should fill up the volume. So how will you, you're right, radial forearm, that free flap can be used. Okay. Yes, sir asked, if the bony reconstruction requires, then what you'll use, sir, is asking. In case if the bony reconstruction is required, then what you'll use?
Fibular.
Again, say radial forearm bone can be used.
Yeah.
Okay. Fibular, very good. Fibula can be used. Okay. If there's a large volume deficit, then what you'll use? What other nasolabial end are there very, you can't use for volume reconstruction. Okay. Any other big flaps, you know, in the body?
Sir, a delta pectoral.
Used for breast reconstruction and all.
The pectoral is major.
Very good. Any other? Wonderful. Okay. Pectoral is major. Myocutaneous flap can be used. And what we should know in these flaps, no? When we're taking the flaps, we should be aware of the blood supplies. On the which artery code, okay, we are taking these, okay, that's for postgraduates. And another is delta pectoral flap, okay, this can be used. Yeah. And for bone, if you want to do bone reconstruction, you can go for
the
simple fibula, radial forearm, radial bone, or else fibular reconstruction you can do.
Yes, sir.
Sir, please.
Yeah, no problem. Yes. Okay, let me ask you a question.
She said, radiotherapy here.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I wanted to ask. What happens if she says don't want surgery? Or what is the role of radiotherapy? Yes, both, sir. Similar questions.
So the patient, if she is not willing for surgery, she is unfit for surgery.
She's fit. She said don't want. I'm scared of you surgeons.
Yeah, she has all the right.
Yes.
Say so.
Yes, sir.
Because
she can be given external beam radiotherapy, sir.
Works well? Or suboptimal?
Sir, it does work well, sir. I mean, because of good vascularity, it does work well, sir.
Squamous cells, T2 lesions work very well. Right? It's almost like if they go to the radiotherapy, if this patient goes to a radiotherapist, he or she will say, look here, we give you radiation and cure you. He comes to the surgeon like you and me, we'll say, we'll operate.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so T1, T2, either one works very well.
For early lesions of tongue, radiotherapy is good. Okay. And for T3, T4 lesions, we can combine along with the surgery. Okay. And as Alex had told, the patient is not willing for the surgery or unfit for surgery, or in the advanced stages like stage 3, stage 4, where it's inoperable, we can go for radiotherapy. Okay. And another thing we should remember, the profession also matters here. So that's why we ask the profession of the patient. Okay. So the one who uses very frequent, like politicians, maybe or lecturers, teachers, use of tongue is more. So in such patients also, we can go for radiotherapy. What are the complications or what are the side effects of commonly radiation. Side effects of radiotherapy? Radiation?
Sir, there can be a soft tissue fibrosis and associated trismus or radiation stomatitis. Or in rare cases, even osteonecrosis of jaw.
What is so rare? Osteonecrosis? Not very rare. Osteoradionecrosis is a described complication.
Okay.
Why do you get osteoradionecrosis?
Sir, due to compromised vascularity.
Only in the mandible, or suppose there's an osteosarcoma of the femur. If I irradiate, can you get osteoradionecrosis?
I'm not sure, sir.
Anybody? Osteoid necrosis is a complication specific to oral cavity or any bone if you irradiate. Scapula. Chondrosarcoma of the scapula if you irradiate. Hardly any blood supply. Will you get osteoid necrosis? No. PK. Why not? Why not? PK was a very famous movie, no sir? Amitabh Bachchan.
Amir Khan,
is it?
Amir Khan.
Yeah, PK, go ahead. Cancellous bone. What does the mandible and the maxilla have? What is not there in the scapula? I have to give you the answer after this.
Alveolar or sockets, sir.
Right. So that's the source of the infection if there is a teeth, which is why when we were students, all patients who went for radiation were made edentulous. All teeth were removed. Then they said, don't take out all teeth. You just take out only the carious teeth. Today, if you talk to good, whatever specialties they are, the dental MDS fellows, they'll say, you just look after the hygiene of the teeth. No longer teeth are extracted. All 32 are extracted. No, doesn't happen.
Okay.
Some tumors, local excision, lumpectomy is first choice. Somebody, 1 minute. There's a doubt here. Radiotherapy is first choice. How do we decide the first step, sir? Some say surgery is better. Some say radiation is better. Can you please enlighten us? Kishan, please enlighten Suman.
No, Mandinath. You're the authority, sir. Sir, please. That's why we called you. We called you because we want to learn from the best. That's why we called you.
Your doubt, you should ask. Don't say sorry to ask the doubt.
Yes.
Okay, welcome the doubt, Sumant. Some tumors, local excision, lumpectomy. Lumpectomy will not come here.
Yes.
Less than small tumors, you can do a wide local excision. In very tiny tumors, you can put iridium needles, radiotherapy. You can start with radiotherapy. Only with such a large tumor where radiotherapy cannot be done as a first choice, can be combined. Some say surgery is better. Yes, as Rajesh said, you come to a surgeon, surgeons will say surgery is better. You first go to a radiotherapist, they say radiotherapy is better. So you don't.
And I think Kishan said it correctly. Kishan said a T1 and a T2 lesion, surgery and radiation, the same. Results are the same. Squamous cell carcinomas are very, very radiosensitive.
Okay.
I hope you answered. Sumant.
Are you okay?
Sumant, I would be very practical in answering this, okay? Theory is different, practical is entirely different. When you come to practice, you'll realize, okay? Four doctors say four different things. This is because, but from their experience, they might have seen the previous results, everything they count when they tell you or suggest you something, okay? So, that's why the difference of if you go with the theory aspects or the guidelines, like sir just now mentioned, for the initial stages or T1, T2, you can go for radiotherapies. Both has got similar results nowadays. It's proven that radiotherapy has got very good results nowadays. So even if for initial stages or T1, T2, you can go for either radiotherapy or surgery is always their option. Okay, surgery is an invasive procedure that you can go anytime. But before that, you can try with the radiotherapy also. But if you go to a good surgeon, he will definitely suggest you surgery before the radiotherapy. Okay. So, squamous cell carcinoma, I remembered a question.
Yes, sir.
Please tell, sir.
Go ahead. Tell us the question.
What's the difference between the squamous cell carcinoma of the skin and mucosa? Any difference is there? This is simple, common sense. We were discussing about that broader classification and all. Many people were telling something. So, I want to know, is there a difference between the squamous cell carcinoma of the skin and mucosa? What is in the histopathology, what is the main difference in the squamous cell carcinoma of the skin and the mucosa? What is not there in the mucosa? I am giving you a clue again.
Stratified squamous epithelium.
Main decalcinization, somebody says.
You can answer him, Kishan.
Yeah. Keratinization is absent in mucosal tumor. So, we can't see the keratin pearls or anything in the mucosal squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, that's how you will differentiate between the squamous cell carcinoma of the skin and the mucosa. And another question would be, what is the most common cause of death in case of oral cavity cancers? Kapil, how does the patient usually die?
Usually from infections, so respiratory tract infection, or the suppurative nodes eroding the vessels.
Oh. What is that? Suppurative? Carotid erosion or carotid artery can be get eroded and bleeding can be there. Most commonly?
Recurrent respiratory tract infection due to aspiration.
No embolism.
Yeah, that's because of aspiration. Because there will be embolism and more excessive salivation will be there. Okay, so during the night it can get aspirated and also there will be absent cough reflex will be there. Okay, so that can lead to death. Sir.
Listen, I think post 2020 you must be careful. Any cause of death, they'll say corona, and you can't.
No. Now it's a simple thing, yeah.
And you can't say no.
Yes, sir.
Kapil, couple of questions about radiation. What do you mean by external beam radiation? Means what?
In brachytherapy, we just keep the pellets over the tumor.
I asked you what is external beam. I didn't ask you brachytherapy.
External beam.
What do you mean by external beam? Is there a source of radiation?
Yes, sir.
What's the source?
Mark the points over the...
No. What is the source? Yeah, source outside the body. Sumant, yes. What is the source? What's emitting the radiation? Cobalt, yes. Any idea what the molecular number is?
Don't know, sir.
60, true. It's a cobalt 60. What comes out? What does the cobalt 60 emit?
Beta radiation, sir.
Really? External beam is beta, is it? Need to know. Certain things you need to know. Right? They usually emit the gamma rays. So you need to know what is a linear accelerator. Okay. You need to know. At least in a theory point of view, you need to know what is IGRT, what is IMRT, that is image guided and intensity modulated. What is a collimator? Basics of radiation you need to know. Somewhere you'll get caught.
Okay, sir.
Understand? Somewhere you'll get caught otherwise. See, more and more of our hospitals are having radiation. So you can't say no, don't know. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Basically, there are two types of radiotherapy. Okay, one is brachytherapy, like you told, brachytherapy, or it's called internal therapy, or external beam radiotherapy, or teletherapy. It's from the distance. From a distance, is radiation is given to the source. In case of posterior 1/3 of the tongue, we can use this teletherapy or this external beam radiotherapy. Whereas for the anterior 2/3, we can what you told, the brachytherapy, right? How you do the brachytherapy? Any idea?
Or we can keep pellets of iridium over the lesion.
Okay.
That's
called what happens to the patient?
Sorry,
walks
sir?
Walks around in the ward.
Over the involved
region. Eric, what happens to the patient? Walks around in the ward.
Sir, there will be emission of radiation from his body, sir. So he has to be quarantined himself.
Where? How long?
At least for 2 weeks, sir.
2 weeks. Corona, is it? Is it? How do you decide?
Sorry, I'm not sure.
Anybody? How do you decide? Surgeon moves out and operates from outside and places pellets inside, whatever that is. Kishan, I can't understand this. Surgeon moves out and operates from outside and places pellets inside, whatever that is.
Telling sir, in radiotherapy, they keep the surgeons, keep the pellets inside, then they walk out of the...
That, yes. But how do you know the person is safe to be discharged? What am I asking otherwise? How do you measure the radiation? What is the instrument used to measure the radiation? That's all. Based on the TID. What's TID? Yeah. I don't know what is TID. Very frank with you. For me, TID is thrice a day.
No, sir. Total, what is it? Dose, total
TLD, sir. TLD, that radiologist will be wearing, no, sir. One.
TLD. Okay, okay. Right. Okay. Okay. What's the instrument used to measure the radiation? Ever heard of a term called a gamma camera? You know, when we were reading, growing up, we were reading spy novels. And those days, they were very famously what was called the Geiger-Müller counter. The medical version of the Geiger-Müller counter is the gamma camera. So you have an instrument which will tell you. And there's a term called decay. So much of the percentage of the radiation has, the radioactive substance has decayed from the body. And unless it comes to a safe percentage, usually it's less than 10. The person is not allowed from isolation. Doesn't take 2 weeks.
Okay, sir.
Is there a place for chemotherapy?
Yes, sir. In T4 lesion, T3, T4 lesion, advanced diseases, extensive, I mean, extracapsular invasion, perineural invasion, we can combine chemo radiation, sir.
Oh, okay. After surgery or instead of surgery?
Sir, as an adjuvant therapy also, it can be given, sir, for T4 lesions. And,
can you repeat the instrument name, sir? Which instrument, PK?
I think he's asking about Geiger-Müller counter.
Yes, Geiger-Müller counter is spy novel. If you're reading James Bond, etc., yes. In the medical field, it's called the gamma camera. Okay? Yes, right, certain things, I think we all of us must agree. We may differ in a few things here and there. If you have a T1 and a T2 lesion, some sort of monotherapy is accepted, be it surgery or radiation. But all of us will agree, if it is a T3 or a T4 lesion, you must give multimodality treatment. However good a surgeon you are, you will need to give adjuvant therapy or neoadjuvant. Understand?
Okay, sir.
Anything else, sir?
No, sir. You do bilateral neck dissection or unilateral?
He said bilateral.
Bilateral. Here it is crossing the midline. So, yeah. So I will go in for bilateral neck dissection, sir.
If you have, you can add on in that and say, if you have a one-sided neck, if you have a one-sided node, becomes an N1 on one side, then you'll probably get away with a supraomo head on the N0 neck side.
Yes, sir.
And you do a functional neck on the involved side. I don't know. Am I confusing?
No, sir. That's what I wanted to.
If in the this nodes patient, are, correct.
Nodes are positive, you go for the FND. The right side, the opposite side, you have to do a
SOH.
Okay. SOH. So always tongue, you should do a bilateral neck dissection.
Okay, sir.
Kishan?
Sir, any doubts from the members?
Any questions you want to...
Any questions? Any clarifications?
Sir, just one doubt, sir.
Yes.
If the FNAC, I'm taking an FNAC from a node, and if it is inconclusive, can I give an antibiotic for 2 weeks and then again repeat, sir? Like what we do in CA penis.
Sir, you want to take it or shall I answer?
You answer, please.
I don't know. Today, I think this, we have to preempt this question in that you get a good ultrasound. And the ultrasound will tell you it's a suspicious area, suspicious feature. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay.
If there is a suspicious node, that's enough for me. Probably I won't even put a needle. Maybe controversial. If you have good ultrasound, the ultrasound person tells you, look here, this node looks malignant, that's enough for me.
Okay, sir.
What, Kishan?
Yes, sir. It's, ultrasound, now the high resolution ultrasound, the sonologists are picking up the nodes very fine and they're giving it whether it is malignant or non-malignant based on the shape, the taller white cells. They're giving the correct picture, Kapil. So based on the ultrasound, you can see if SARS, as he said, if there's doubtful, you proceed with your neck dissection rather than putting in a needle and destroying the field. Okay.
Okay, sir.
How is occult metastasis node detected preoperative or does it require frozen section? How is occult metastasis in a node detected preoperative? You get an ultrasound. That's what we're discussing.
So yeah.
Look at the ultrasound features.
And sir, do we have to mention about PET scan during the metastatic workup? Is it necessary, sir?
Personally, no. But it's a difficult question to answer. Scientific evidence, no. No, sir?
Yes, sir. They see, some people will ask, do you have an MRI in your hospital?
Role of sentinel node biopsy here.
There is no sentinel node.
I don't think it's called a sentinel node. Any suspicious node, you treat it depending on the suspicion.
And here the skip metastasis is also very common. Okay?
Yes.
Sentinel may not be that good here.
Yes.
So there may not be any nodes here. There will be nodes in the posterior triangle alone.
Yes.
So you have to look for the nodes everywhere.
Okay, so concluding remarks from the mentors, please. First, Srinivasan sir, and then Ballal sir.
No. He has done well. He has done well. Some questions, as I said, everybody at the postgraduate, I say the basic clinical examination should be thorough one, because you get stuck in that one, the examiners will find. They'll also be stuck in the examination, so they will not go to the treatment aspect in detail. So that's what. So Kapil, you have to read a bit, as I said, about the anatomy of the tongue.
Yes, sir.
We got an oral cavity, because it's very, very important. When you say examination of 9, 10, and 12, I wanted to catch you. How well did you examine 9, 10? Then if you have a doubt, go back and read Hutchison's clinical methods today.
Yes, sir.
When you commit something, you come with confidence. Otherwise, you are very good. You are a bit, he's on admission day duty, sir. So he came in between. you have done well, Kapil.
Yeah.
Simple. Post-graduation examination is nothing different from undergraduate, okay? You don't think post-graduation something hi-fi, they'll ask some only will complicated things will be asked. Nothing like that. Even there also, basics only will be asked. And if you answer the basics, you'll be passed, okay? But thing is that more of practically oriented questions will be asked, because since you worked for 3 years in the wards, in the OT and all, so they'll ask you some practically, see, how do you really examine the patient? How do you in the OT, what really you do? These kind of questions will be asked for postgraduates. But theory-wise, as far my knowledge is concerned, both undergraduate and postgraduates will have a similar set of questions by the examiners. But if you answer that much, you'll be through. Okay, sir? Am I right, sir?
Yeah,
correct. Kishan, theoretical aspect they can read. Actually, whether he worked in the ward or not, to know that is of whether has he really examined the patient.
Yeah.
As he said, how did you flex? Why do you want to flex?
Yeah.
So these are the basic things you should know before presenting.
No. This is not for the exam. This is only for my friends. I'm giving a secret. Easy way to pass in the exam is if you know whatever you have written in the exam, your paper. If you know why you have written, two reasons for every word, whatever you have written, you are passed. So like, see, sir, didn't ask anything out of your case presentation. Whatever your word, you mentioned pain, then sir asked why there is pain. You asked there is a deviation of, see, that's all. Whatever you have written, sir asked why, that's all. Yes. Okay, nothing out of the presentation. So before writing something in the paper, know the reason why you are writing that. Why have you asked that question? If you're not sure, please don't go to mention about that. If you mentioned something, you committed something, that means you should know the reason for that. That's all. Got my point, Mr. Kapil?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Ballal, sir, please, your concluding remark.
To put it differently, I would say this. If you have problems with the IGRT versus IMRT, means you pass the exam. No doubt about that at all.
You're coming from the other end. If an examiner go to IGRT, IRT, IMRT, and collimator, the cobalt therapy, the dose, that means you're crossed the level.
Yes.
You're going to get high marks.
That's what.
Myself and Kishan started from the basic. Sir is coming from there. Okay.
Right, sir. I've enjoyed myself. I hope you guys have learned something, sir. That's all.
Sir, definitely, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Kishan, very much. Kishan, thanks.
Pallavi?
It's a very comprehensive clinical class. We could learn a lot from the wonderful
discussion. We can't hear you, Pallavi.
It was indeed a very comprehensive clinical class, sir. We could learn a lot from the discussion. Thank you so much, Professor Rajesh Ballal, sir, and Professor Srinivasan, sir, for your valuable inputs. And the amazing discussion, sir.
You must, we will always need your blessings. You must thank Kishan for organizing this.
Organizing anybody can do, sir. But teaching, most of them doesn't do, sir. Such a, we want to learn from the best. So we invited you today and you graciously agreed to be with us and teach us. And we also request you to be with us in the future also. As and when we are free at your convenience, please take us some classes, sir.
You call your convenience. I'll come. That's all.
Yes, sir. And yeah, we know the weaknesses of you, such you sir. You are such professors, such teachers, you can never say no to teaching. So we catch hold of such your weaknesses and
thank you,
you can
sir.
Never say no. You can never say no to teaching, at least to your students. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable
time. Thanks, sir. Thanks, Kishan.
And thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Kapil, thank you, so Kapil.
Sir. And Kapil, well done.
Thank you, Dr. Kapil, sir, for the great effort, because of which we could gather a lot of points. And
thank you.
Thank all the participants for the active participation.
Thank you, sir.
One and all.
Thank you.